Lydia Sherman, afflicted with an unfortunate affection for murder, ventured on a chilling decades-long killing spree across New York and Connecticut, poisoning no fewer than 8 children and 3 of her husbands. Her sensational trial in 1872 garnered widespread attention, leading to newspaper headlines that branded her as America's Queen Killer, the Poison Fiend, the modern-day Lucretia Borgia, or simply, the Derby Poisoner. During the time preceding her trial, she penned a best-selling confession titled The Poison Fiend, Life, Crimes, and Convictions of Lydia Sherman. Lydia Sherman's childhood, marked by the unfortunate loss of her mother shortly after her birth in Burlington, New Jersey in 1824, offered few clues to predict her transformation into a serial killer. Raised on her uncle's farm until the age of 16, she later relocated to New Brunswick to live with her brother. Despite the absence of early indicators, Lydia's physical attributes were described as slim and pretty, adorned with blue eyes, dark hair, and porcelain skin. Her strong attachment to the Methodist Church played a role in shaping her character. At 18, she attended a Methodist dinner where she encountered Edward Struck, a widowed blacksmith with 6 children. Following a brief courtship, he proposed marriage and they established their household in New York City, eventually expanding their family to 8 children. Facing the financial strains of supporting a large family, Edward Struck sought additional income by becoming a New York City police officer. However, a few years into the job, he faced charges of cowardice during a hotel robbery in Manhattan, leading to his dismissal. Lydia Sherman's disturbing trajectory from a seemingly ordinary life to that of a serial killer highlights the puzzling nature of criminal behavior, leaving a haunting legacy that still echoes in historical accounts of nefarious crimes. In the depths of his depression, Edward Struck succumbed to a state of despair, confining himself to the apartment in his bed. Lydia, observing his suffering, made a harrowing decision to alleviate him from his misery. Seeking a lethal solution, she ventured to the local drugstore where obtaining arsenic, readily available as a rat-killing poison in the 19th century, proved profoundly simple. With a sinister intent, she added a small thimble of arsenic to Edward's oatmeal, a quantity so seemingly insignificant yet potent enough to bring about a man's demise. The following hours were marked by a chain of torment for Edward. Initially, his throat burned, followed by excruciating abdominal pains and diarrhea, turning into convulsions that led to his eventual and imminent death. This grim, somber chapter unfolded against the backdrop of a tragedy months prior when their 2-year-old daughter contracted measles and passed away to similar symptoms. Although Lydia Sherman never admitted to the act of killing her, she would later confess to the horrifying crimes of taking the lives of 8 other innocent children. The account paints a disturbing portrait of a woman whose actions veered into the darkest realms of human cruelty and misery. As the Civil War raged on, Lydia Sherman constructed chaos within the confines of her own household. Faced with the grim reality of lacking any means of support and burdened with the responsibility of caring for her young children, Lydia made a chilling decision regarding her 3 youngest children, Martha Ann, age 6, Edward Jr., age 4, and William, a mere 9 months. Rationing that they could not do anything for her or themselves, she decided to discard of them in the same sinister style she had disposed of their father. In a wicked turn of events, less than 6 weeks after the death of Edward Struck, Lydia administered a fatal dose of poison to her 3 innocent children. Some of her older children managed to avoid the tragedy, albeit temporarily, by finding employment to sustain the family. However, the specter of demise continued to haunt the household. George, who was 14, fell victim to lead poisoning he got from his job as a painter. Tragically, he made a fatal mistake of taking to his bed, where his mother administered arsenic to his tea, sealing his untimely fate. The gloomy string of death continued as Lydia's 12-year-old daughter, Ann Eliza, became the next target. Without gainful employment and plagued by persistent illness, she succumbed to her mother's malevolent actions. John, aged 16, had wisely moved out of the house, likely sparing him from a similar fate. The last child at home, 18-year-old Lydia, held a job as a retail clerk. However, she fell victim to illness, forcing her to stay bedridden. In a sinister repetition to the pattern established earlier, Lydia Sherman disposed of her daughter in the same callous manner as the others. The narrative takes an unsettling turn as Lydia, after eliminating her own family members, transitioned to a new role. She secures employment as a nurse. This morbid twist serves as a stark proof of the depths of her viciousness, revealing a woman whose actions bordered on the unimaginable, leaving a trail of tragedy and despair in her wake. As the Civil War drew to a close, Lydia's stepson, Cornelius Struck, harbored growing suspicions about her conduct. Troubled by his concerns, he shared them with the district attorney, who promised an investigation. However, despite the assurance, no substantive inquiry took place. With the close of the Civil War, Lydia embarked on a new chapter by securing employment selling sewing machines in New York City. During this time, she encountered John Curtis, a customer who was impressed by the 41-year-old's nursing experience. In 1867, Curtis hired Lydia to care for his elderly mother in Stratford, Connecticut. After spending 8 months with the elderly lady, Lydia's path took a fateful turn when she crossed paths with Dennis Holbert, a wealthy widower in a local grocery store. Despite the passage of time, Lydia retained her looks and possessed enough charm to convince Holbert that he needed her as a housekeeper. Embracing the opportunity, Lydia accepted the position, and it wasn't long before Holbert proposed marriage. On November 22, 1868, Lydia marries Dennis Holbert, ensuring that he included her in his will. However, just 14 months into their marriage, Lydia observed Dennis experience tremors while shaving for church. Afflicted with dizziness, he could not shake it off. Lydia concluded that he suffered from some kind of affliction. To alleviate his suffering, she administered a substantial dose of arsenic in his clam chowder. The following 3 days were marked by excruciating agony for Dennis, ending with his death. In the aftermath, Lydia inherited $20,000 worth of real estate, which is well over $400,000 in today's money, and $10,000 in cash, which is more than $200,000 today. Eight weeks later, Lydia's unsettling journey continued as she encountered Horatio Sherman, a factory mechanic in Derby, Connecticut, who was recently widowed and had 4 children. Swiftly, they married within a few months, and Lydia relocated to Derby, adding in another layer of complexity to her dark and mysterious history. In blissful ignorance to his wife's sinister tendencies, Horatio Sherman indulged in heavy drinking and freely spent the money Lydia accumulated. One fateful day, inebriated and ranting, he expressed a wish for his ailing infant son, Frankie, to perish and end his suffering. Seizing on that grim suggestion, Lydia discreetly mixed a small amount of arsenic in the baby's milk, resulting in a swift and tragic demise. The following month, her 14-year-old stepdaughter, Ada, fell ill with the flu. While doctors proved helpless, Lydia, armed with her sinister knowledge, took matters into her own hands, ensuring Ada's untimely end. The death of Ada had a profound impact on Horatio, driving him to drown his sorrows in a bender. Unfazed by the consequences, Lydia resolved to worsen her husband's condition by spiking a bottle of brandy with arsenic. As he retreated to his bed, Lydia left poison brandy by his bedside. When Dr. J.C. Beardsley arrived to attend to Horatio, he became suspicious of the peculiar symptoms exhibited by the ailing man. Inevitably, Horatio succumbed to the poison, prompting Dr. Beardsley to request a post-mortem examination. Lydia Sherman, perhaps with a deliberate casualness, consented to the procedure. The investigation took a more damning turn as Dr. Beardsley sent Horatio Sherman's organs to Yale for analysis. Yale professor George Frederick Barker's findings confirmed the presence of significant amounts of arsenic in Horatio Sherman's body, exposing Lydia's evil actions. Subsequent autopsies conducted on Dennis Hurlburt, Frankie, and Ada Sherman further revealed the insidious traces of arsenic, cementing Lydia Sherman's role as a purveyor of death in the most malicious sense. Lydia Sherman's dark journey led her to New Brunswick, where she lived with a family. However, on June 7, 1872, the wheels of justice caught up with her, and she was arrested by police for murder. Subsequently, she was transported to New Haven to await trial. Her trial commenced on April 16, 1872, spanning 8 days. In the courtroom, Lydia presented a composed and proper demeanor. Adorned in a black alpaca dress, a shawl, gloves, and a straw hat with a thin veil, despite her outward composure, she firmly maintained her innocence. However, faced with the abundance of overwhelming evidence, the jury reached a verdict convicting her of second-degree murder of Horatio Sherman. Tabloid sensationalized the trial, dubbing it the horror of the century. 5 years into her prison sentence, Lydia orchestrated an escape by feigning a serious illness. During her taste of freedom, she secured employment as a housekeeper for a wealthy widower in Providence. Fortunately for him, he survived his acquaintance with Lydia, as authorities tracked her down after a week and promptly returned her to prison in Wethersfield, Connecticut. Lydia Sherman's dark tale reached its conclusion on May 16, 1878, when she succumbed to cancer, bringing an end to life marked by malice and tragedy. That will do it for this video. If you haven't already and you enjoyed the video, please hit the like button, share, comment, and subscribe. Stay curious, everyone, and see you next time.